the important concept today that we are going to see is all about the basic concepts of your developmental biology. Yes, everyone. So this developmental biology, as such, it is a really a high yielding concept, because I know majority of the questions that are being asked up in your examination are pretty direct from your books. Yes. So what is the most commonly used book for studying your developmental biology? It is going to be none other than your Gilbert. So if you are not having a copy of Gilbert, just you can look at this NCBI bookshelf. So there you will get a free copy of your basic things from the Gilbert. Oh yes, so this is me, Dr. Saranya. I am talking to you on your developmental biology basic concepts. So to tell about me, I have already completed my PhD after duly cracking that. Fine. So in this class, I will tell you know what you should study from this developmental biology such that you will get a better score. All right. So before beginning off with the basic concepts, I will just tell you the total story of your developmental biology. Yes, so what is being covered under this development, and what is actually not coming off under. Okay, yes. So if you take up the total important concept, it is going to begin up with the fertilization. Yes, everybody. So the total one, it is beginning with the fertilization. Right. So under this fertilization, you will be studying, you must be studying about the sea urchin fertilization. Yes. And then this human or the mammalian fertilization. Right. So the second important concept is going to be the cleavage. So here it is going to tell you about the pattern of cleavage. Right. Oh yes, yes, Chihya Singh, welcome to the class. Yes, Chaya, very good evening. Fine. So if you take human, what is going to be the cleavage pattern? Oh yes, yes, Deepak. Oh yes, of course. Weekly, I will be meeting you up 2 days a week. All right, fine. So the timing is going to remain the same, but the dates, it is going to be 2 days a week. Yes, Deepak, yeah. So the second one that you have to study is the cleavage pattern. Alright, so if it is going to be human, it is going to be holoblastic as well as the rotational one. Alright, oh yes, Sumaya, welcome to the class, Sumaya. Fine, so the next one that we are going to study, or you have will be studying in your developmental biology, it is about this gastrulation. Okay, so even under this cleavage, you might get to match the following. Okay, so what your sea urchin is going to do, what your tunicate is going to do, what your sea elegans, what is the pattern of cleavage. So everything, you just make a mini table, so that will be enough for you. Likewise, gastrulation. If you take the gastrulation, you will get questions like, what is going to be this involution? What is going to be this ingression? What is epipole? Right, so all these basic concepts you will be getting the questions of with, right? And then after this gastrulation, you will be getting off from your organogenesis. Yes, so organogenesis, you are getting the development of the organs, majorly lymph development, yes, vulva development, C. elegans, and then the limbs development. Next step, it is going to be this metamorphosis. All right, fine. So yes, Radhika, welcome to the class. So under metamorphosis, you will know the importance of this egg dizone hormone. Okay, so your 20 hydroxy egg dizone, that is serving as a metamorphic hormone, and it is going to help in this molting, and finally this larva or your form, it is getting ready to develop into an adult. Right? Fine. So this is the total cycle you will be studying of round and round in your developmental biology. So this is regarding your animal development. Like this, in your plant development, you have to study about the floral development. Yes, you have your ABC flowering pattern. And then what is your shoot apical meristem? And what is your root apical meristem? And then you must focus on what is going to be this double fertilization. Yes, Raksha, come on, welcome to the class, Raksha. Oh yes, yeah, Veena, welcome to the class, Veena. Absolutely, yes, yes. So you will be studying about your double fertilization. Yes, so apart from these, what else you should study and what is being expected, I will be just telling you around. Yes, so that is going to include your new relation. Okay, so far not much questions have been asked with the new relation and new neural fold formation. Yes, so definitely this is a must study topic. Apart from that, you will get the questions from your axis development. Yes, so under axis development, you have your amphibian axis. Yes, that is your Spearman organizer. All right, chick axis. So what is going to be the chick organizer? Quick. What is going to be the chick organizer? It is called as the Henson's node. All right, so that is a very important topic. And what about the fish? You have this embryonic shield, right? So this is a very important organizer in your fish. Yes, and then you have to study about your mammalian development. Even that is very important. Apart from that, this Drosophila development. All right, so these are the next category of topics that will be coming up, right? So apart from that, you will get questions from your regeneration. Yes, fine. And then you might get questions from your basic concepts. So this basic concept is what we are going to focus today. So what is coming under this basic concepts? Shall we see it up one by one? All right. So this basic concepts, it is going to include up with the key terms like your competence. Yes. So this is what we are going to see today. Competence, induction. All right. And then your specification, very important topic. Yes, induction, competence, specification, determination, differentiation, also thing. And then, you will get questions something like your cytoplasmic differentiation. Okay, yes. So you have a difference in how your cytoplasmic inheritance is being made. And you might get questions from your morphogenetic gradients. All right, fine. So this is what we are going to see up today. All right. Yes, Veena. No, I am just dealing with the key developmental biology concepts. Okay, so these are all the basic concepts. Your unit 5A, that is what we are dealing it today. Got it, everyone? Yes, so this is all going to be the basic concepts in your developmental biology. Yes, so we are doing it up with the 5A. Yes, so that is what we are doing up today. Got it, everyone? Fine? Yes. So if we take up this induction, yes. So who is an inducer? Yes. Who is an inducer? Who is going to give the signal? Isn't it? Yes. So that is what it is called as an induction. If you take the lens development, who is going to serve as an inducer? That is going to be this optical vesicle. Yes, so this optical vesicle, that is going to serve as an inducer, right? So it is going to tell kindly develop into a optical lens development. Fine. So the receiver is there, but the receiver, it should have the competence. What I mean is that, see, I am helping you to understand your CSIR net. Okay, I am meant for the life science. Fine. So if at all there is going to be a physical science student, by chance they are attending this class, okay? So will it be useful to them? I am giving every tip that is, that will be essential for you to crack your life science. If some physics students is coming and sitting, will they get any knowledge out of it? Definitely not. That is what. Even though this inducer is present, you require the competence. If the competence is not there, then this responder, it may not respond properly. You got it? Yes, everyone? So shall we see what is going to be this competence factor? Right? Okay. So this competence, it is being given off by an important gene that is called as your PAC6. All right? So the PAC6, it is going to be the competence factor. Got it? Yes. So I told you about your inducer. So who is this inducer? Yes, Raksha. So who is the inducer now? The optical vesicle. Okay, fine. Right. So who is the responder that is receiving the signal? The responder, it is going to be the head ectoderm. All right. So who is giving the signal? The inducer is giving the signal. Who is receiving the signal? It is going to be the responder, that is the head ectoderm that is receiving the signal, right? But in between those two, you have a competence factor. You got it, everyone? So that is the key concept in your competence and induction. So shall we repeat? So this is a very two important concept that we are studying today. Number one, it is going to be this induction. Number two, it is going to be the competence. Right? So who is the inducer for the lens? Who is going to serve as an inducer for the lens? It is going to be your optical vesicle, no doubt. Your optical vesicle, it is going to serve as an inducer. Right? Yes, 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 Sumi. So who is going to be the responder? The responder is going to be the head ectoderm. Right? So what is making this head ectoderm to be the responder? It is going to be the competence factor. So that competence factor is what is PAXIS. Alright, so I put a hypothesis in front of you. You have a trunk ectoderm, okay? There is no head, but you just imagine that there is a trunk ectoderm. So will it respond to this optical vesicle? So will it respond to your optical vesicle? Just think of and tell me. So instead of head, you are giving the signal to the trunk. Will the trunk respond? Will the trunk respond? True or false? Come on, everybody. Quick, quick. So will the trunk respond? No, the trunk is not responding. I told you, your optical vesicle is exactly like me. So I am an inducer. So, if I am going to, yes Raksha, if I am going to induce a physics students, will it be a use to them? No. So, they will not respond, isn't it? So, those who are needing this instruction, you will only assimilate the information and respond to me. Obviously, the same thing is happening with the inducer. Alright? So, your optical vesicle, it is going to be the inducer. Right? But the receiver, oh yes. Yeah, everybody. Yes, 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 absolutely. So this receiver, yeah, it should be only the head ectoderm. So how it is classified as a receiver? It is because it is having the competence factor that is called as PAXIS. So in trunk, there is no PAXIS. So it is not going to receive the signal that is given by the vesicle. Oh yes, yes, Rohan. Rohan says that, does it mean that the cells that have a particular receptor for a hormone or factor, it is going to be competent for the hormone or factor? Absolutely. Yes. So if at all your optical vesicle, it is wanting to induce, it needs a receiver. So who is the receiver? It is the competent factor. Here in this case, absolutely. Yes, here in this case, what happens? Your optical vesicle is giving the signal, but who should receive it? Only the head ectoderm is capable of receiving it. Why? Only the head is containing the PAXIS. Okay, yeah. So a very beautiful experiment is actually done with this same point. So I will give you a table. So before we go into the specification, I thought this is a very important one. So I will just give you a table. First, see, your optical vesicle is there. Okay, fine. Yes, yes. Deepak. So cytoplasmic determinant. Oh yes, we will do the cytoplasmic determinant. Soon after this, we will be doing with the cytoplasmic determinants. Yes, everybody. So see, your optical vesicles is being present. Right? But your head ectoderm, the PAXIS is minus. Okay? So what will happen? The lens formation will take place or no lens will take place? Lens formation will be happening or there is going to be no lens. So what will happen to the lens formation? Yes. Optical vesicle is there. Head ectoderm is there. But you mutated the PAXIS. So lens will form or it will not form? Yes, lens will form, it will not form. What will happen? Come on. Lens will not form. Why? Even though your head ectoderm is there, absolutely Shivani, yes Raksha, even though your head ectoderm is there, This pack 6 is minus, so no lens formation. Second one, if optical vesicle is there and in your head ectoderm, you have the pack 6, right? It is positive. So, lens is going to form, right? In third one, in case of the optical vesicle, you have the optical vesicle. So, that is going to be pack 6, right? Oh, yes, Shravan. Yes, Shravan Mishra. Yeah, Shivani. So this one it is going to be a wild type. Okay, that means it is a normal pack 6 positive. Now what will happen? Lens will form or it will not form? Now in your optical vesicle they made them to be pack 6 negative. Right? So now what will happen? Lens will form, it will not form. What will happen to the lens formation? Here lens will form normally. Why normal? Your optical vesicle is the inducer. It doesn't need the pack 6. Who needs the pack 6? Only the receiver is needing the pack 6. So in this condition, your receiver is having your wild type pack 6. So your optical vesicle doesn't matter. It needs only the, it is serving as an inducer only. So if your pack 6 is negative or positive, it doesn't matter a lot. Understood? Yes, everybody? So if at all now your optical vesicle, it is given with a pack 6, but your head ectoderm is pack 6 negative. Now what will happen? Yes, now there is no lens. Got it? Because only this head ectoderm, it needs the pack 6. If the pack 6 is not there in your head ectoderm, obviously there is no lens formation. This is seriously a very, very important information regarding your induction and competence, right? Absolutely. The receiver should only have. See, I am teaching you. So, if I study all the concepts 100%, you will get marks? No. You should study for your own exam. How much ever I teach, whatever you are receiving only, you are going to give it in your exams. The same way. Okay, so your optical vesicle, that should contain all the signals to induce. But the receiver should contain the pack 6 such that the lens will be formed. Yes, everyone? So I hope that now this is all clear to it. Fine. So coming to your cytoplasmic determination. Yes, so the cytoplasm, this is not evenly distributed. Okay, so if you take your cytoplasm, it is not evenly distributed. What happens among the cytoplasmic factors? No, one is getting the total portion. Maybe the other is not receiving it only. Okay. Yes. Yeah, Raksha. Absolutely. So that is what it is taking place in terms of your cytoplasmic inheritance. So I will give you a very classical example. By that only you will understand this concept. So have you studied the C. elegans development? Yes? So in C. elegans, you have this P1 and AB cell, isn't it? So if you take your Z0, it is going to form your P1 and AB. Then what happens? Your P1 is dividing to form P2 and EMS. Yes, your AB is dividing to form your ABA and ABP, right? So now you just think of all the germ cell and all the P granules, it is transmitted to P1 to P2. Yes, this AB is not getting a single piece of your P granule. Likewise, this EMS is not getting a single granule of P. Right? Yes, yes. So P, it is referring to the posterior and this is the stem cell. You got it? So the total ability of the stem cell is transmitted only to the P1. This AB in the anterior, it is only the founder cell. It is going to be a simple cell, somatic cell. This is not getting a piece of information from your P granule. Got it? So this is what it is called as your cytoplasmic inheritance. The total thing is given only to the daughter. So there is an inequivalence that is being created. Right? So it is called sometimes as your cytoplasmic diminution. Right? Why it is diminished? See, in AB you are not receiving any P granule. The total P is done only with your P1. Got it? So this is the cytoplasmic inheritance. As everybody is always mothers, no, they give it to one of their daughters. Got it, everyone? Fine. So let us make a move into the most important concept that was planned for the day. So that is going to be your differentiation and specification. All right. So if the development of, yes, everyone. So the development of a specialized cell, so that is called as the differentiation. Okay. So if you take the stem cells, so what type of cells are the stem cells? Yes. Stem cells, what type of cells are they? Quick. Stem cells are undifferentiated cells, isn't it? So they are not differentiated yet. That is why it is having an ability to give rise to any type of cell. Okay, fine. So after that, you know, it is becoming committed to a particular phase. Each type of cell, it has a specialized function. If you take a keratinocyte, it is giving, you know, your keratin. So what the keratin is doing, it is giving the protection against your aberration. Likewise, if you take this melanocyte, it is giving this melanin. So that is a pigment. Like that, each and every cell is having a particular function to be taking place. All right, fine. So now coming to the most important part of the lecture, that is on your specification. Okay, fine. So if you take that, your cell is becoming committed. So what do you mean by commitment? Maybe you just think of your standard 10. Yes, in standard 10, you could have learnt social science, civics, history, geography. You could have learnt English. You could have learnt, you know, science. Yes, you could have learnt maths. You remember that? So this is the uncommitted state. Yes, Raksha. So your cytoplasm is, of course, you know, giving you everything. Right. So what happens in this before this commitment? Yes, you study everything, but after your standard 12th or your PU, you become committed only to this biology. Yes, maybe somebody can take up your biomaths. Right. So this is what is called a specification. Later, if you go on, you just go on specifying the topic, and your PhD, you do a ultra specified topic. Got it? The same story with your cells, right? So initially your cell, it is going to get committed. So here absolutely it is fixed. You cannot go back and you cannot do a social science now. Got it? Right. So the first stage, it is called as your specification. Yes. So here the fate of a cell, it is going to get specified. Fine. So whenever it is getting specified, it will differentiate autonomously. All right, fine. So there are two types of specification. One, it is going to be your autonomous specification. Three types are there. Okay, one, it is going to be your autonomous specification. Another one, it is called as your conditional specification. And the third one, it is called as your syncytial specification. So these three type of specifications are there for your cells. Right, so that is the first stage of commitment. So this, oh yes, welcome to the class, everyone. Yes, Kareem Khan, welcome to the class. So the second step of commitment, this first step, I will call this like an engagement. Why? Because it is reversed. All right, fine. So it is reversible. That is what is called as the specification. But in the second stage, it has become irreversible. So this is something like a marriage. Okay, so this is totally irreversible. It is becoming too much determined. Yes, everybody. So if you take this commitment, yes, so this commitment is of two type. Yes, so like your engagement, you have the specification, right? So this is going to be a reversible form, right? So this is only of three types: autonomous specification, conditional specification, and syncytial specification. And one more type, it is going to be this determination. Yes, so under the determination, it is going to be fixed, right? It is going to be irreversible. Got it, everyone? So this is all clear to you. What is a commitment? What is it, this thing? Oh yes. Okay, Kareem, come on. Right. So next, coming off to your autonomous specification. All right. So if you take off with your autonomous specification, yes, so there is going to be three basic models of your commitment. So among them, the first one I told you is all about your autonomous specification. All right. So if you take up your autonomous specification, what it is telling about your autonomous specification? This autonomous means it is highly independent. All right. Fine. So you can think on your own, isn't it? So that is what it is called as the independent thinking. Isn't it? So see, you decide on your own. You are not relying on anybody else. Isn't it? Yes. So this autonomous specification, it is going to be a highly independent one. So what happens, even if you remove the particular blastomere, right? So if you remove a particular cell stage of the blastomere, right? And then you put off, right, into a Petri plate, even then it is going to develop into the destiny. Fine. So the destiny of this one, it is not going to change. All right. So that is what is called as the autonomous specification. All right. So if you take up an embryo, okay, so maybe you just take off the cell that is destined to become this trophoblast. All right. So if it is going to become trophoblast, it is ultimately going to become trophoblast. Even if you isolate this particular cell and you put it into a Petri dish, it is not going to develop into any other cell, but still it is going to develop into only your trophoblast. Right, everyone? So I think that this is all clear to you about your autonomous specification. All right. So if you take a particular blastomere, you remove it from your embryo, and then this isolated blastomere, it is going to produce the same cells, right? But still it is going to be this part of the embryo. Got it? Clear? All right, everybody. Fine. So what will happen to this embryo? See, for instance, if you take this embryo, all right? So this embryo, this particular cell is destined to become the eye. Okay? Yes. So you have isolated this particular cell from this embryo and you have put them in a Petri dish. All right. So what will happen here? Yes, everybody? An eye is going to develop in your Petri dish. That is fine. Right. But what will happen to this embryo? Will this embryo contain any eye? No. This embryo, it is going to lack the eye. Got it? Yes. So this embryo, it is going to lack the eye, but the Petri dish, it is going to contain the eye. That is your autonomous specification. So you call this autonomous specification as a mosaic development. Okay, so you call them as a mosaic. Yes, because what, have you ever seen a mosaic tile in your area? How it will looking like? It will be containing so much of differentiated patterns, isn't it? Right. So the best example, these invertebrate embryos, especially if you take off this mollusk, this annelid, this tunicates, yes, so they are also using your autonomous specification to determine the fate of the cells. Got it, everyone? Fine. All right. Come on, everybody. So let us take an in-depth understanding onto your autonomous specification. So your autonomous specification, it is going to give rise to the pattern of development. So that is what is called as your mosaic development, right? Okay. So shall we do a mini recap of the things that we have seen so far? Come on, everyone. Yes. So the first thing that we have seen about the specification is, the specification is about the commitment that you are having towards the thing. Right. So under this commitment, yes, so you have your specification. And one more commitment we were seeing. What is that? Yes. Specification as well as the determination. Right. Okay. So specification as well as the determination. So under the specification, it is going to be of three types. All right. So the first one, it is going to be your autonomous specification. Second one, it is going to be your conditional specification. And third one, it is going to be your syncial specification. Got it? Fine. So we have just now completed with your autonomous specification. So under the autonomous specification, so under this autonomous specification, we have been seeing that, yes, so this is going to develop into a mosaic pattern. So what do you mean by this mosaic pattern? The mosaic pattern is telling you that it is having an independence, right? So it is going to be highly independent, right? That means all the factors, they are present within, right? Okay, come on. So this autonomous, it is telling that it is highly independent and all the factors are, it has been, present within these, within these things. So that is why whenever you are isolating this particular stuff and you are putting it into the petri dish, you are developing the particular organ. But what happens to the embryo, I told you? This embryo, it is going to lack of, the particular thing. Yes, everyone? So I hope that this is clear. We'll make a move into your morphogenetic determinants. Right. So what are these morphogenetic determinants? See, these morphogenetic determinants that are placed in different regions of the egg. Okay, so they are apportioned to the different cells as your embryo is going to get divided. Alright everyone, come on, let us focus here. So these morphogenetic determinants, they are going to specify the cell type. Right, so what has happened in case of your determinants, it is going to tell the instruction to the cells. Okay, fine. So which cell is going to become what? That is highly specified by such morphogenetic determinants. You got it? So what do you mean by your morphogenetic determinants? Right. So these morphogenetic determinants are highly specified and it is only going determine the total stuff. All right. So let us see a little bit more into detail. Fine. So if you take a tunicate embryo. All right. Fine. So this tunicate embryo, it is going to give you, yes, so it is going to give you an autonomous specification. Alright? Fine. So this tunicate embryo, it is exactly, it is giving off with your autonomous specification. Right. So what happens during the tunicate embryo, it is going to contain four different regions. So that too in your 8-cell stage, it will have 8 different cells. Alright. So what it is going to contain of? For example, it is going to contain your A4.1, right? B4.1. Alright. And then it is going to contain your A4.2, B4.2, like that. Okay. So what experiment they performed is that if at all they are going to remove such region. So I told you it 8-cell stage is nothing but it is a replica of your 4-cell stage. So here, if at all you are removing this B4.1, alright, yes. So this B4.1 is what it is responsible for the muscles, I told you, right? So this B4.1, it is going to be responsible for the muscles. So if at all, you are removing this B4.1, right? So if you remove this B4.1, what will happen? So there is going to be no muscle, isn't it? So there is no muscle within the organism. So this muscle is totally gone, right? But now they performed a beautiful experiment, right? So they are performing a beautiful experiment where they just wanted to show that this B4.1 is responsible for the muscle. Right. So what they did with this experiment, it is that they were able to give off the different removal. Okay. So if you remove this A4.1, it was able to form this ectoderm independently. Why? I told you that all the factors, they are present within, isn't it? So it was ultimately able to get off with the total one. But if you remove this B4.1, then what is happening? This muscles, it is not yet being produced of. Right? Yeah, everyone. So that is the total effect of your autonomous one. Right? Okay, everyone. Come on. So let us see in detail. Right. So he made the mole formations. Yes. So how did you set up the mole formation? I told you that it is divided into four regions. If it is going to be your A4.1 and then this B4.1, this A4.1 is responsible for your ectoderm. Got it? Right. And what about this B4.1? This B4.1 is responsible for the muscle cell. So who is making the muscle? Some kind of factors, okay, some kind of cytoplasmic factor. It is only determining that this should become a muscle. So in the next experiment, what he did, he wanted to push this cytoplasm into this neighbor one. Okay, so this neighbor, it is going to be your normal, A4.2. So what he did, he tried to use a needle and he pushed this cytoplasm into this A4.2. If this A4.2 is gone into the cytoplasm, B4.1 cytoplasm is now pushed to A4.2. Now what will happen? Can you imagine? Yes, everyone. So now what is happening? This is going to become like a muscle. So who is determining? It is not the cell, but actually this cytoplasm is only determining that this cell should behave in this manner. Yes, everybody. So shall we all repeat it one more time? Come on. So let us take an 8-cell stage. So in this 8-cell stage, what happens? It is having your A4.1 as well as this B4.1 cells. Likewise, you have your A4.2, A4.3, everything, B4.4, everything, it is there. Fine. So now what they are doing? They are taking up this cytoplasm. The cytoplasm is being present within here. So now they try to put this cytoplasm over the other one. So now what happened? This blastomere, it became able to develop into a, yes. So this region, it became able to develop into a muscle cell. So where is this autonomous ability? It is present. It is all dictated one and only by the cytoplasm. Got it? Fine. So if at all it is not going to contain this particular blastomere, if your B4.1 is absent, then there is going to be no muscle. Got it, everyone? So this is clear. So this is the total understanding you have to take up regarding your autonomous specification. Alright, fine. So this Whittaker, he performed a very important experiment. So that helped to determine this cytoplasmic segregation. So what he did, he used this acetylcholine esterase as a marker. Okay, fine. So this acetylcholine esterase, it is used as a marker for your muscle cells. So what happened? He used a label and he labeled this acetylcholine esterase. So this acetylcholine esterase, it was produced more only in which region? B4.1 region. By that he was able to identify that is going to contain. Alright. So the next important experiment, it is going to be with Whittaker. So before that, I would like to announce this importance of our CSIR course that is being provided by Unacademy. So here we strive hard to give you the quality education where we are providing up the maximum resource for you such that you will be able to crack your net from the home only. Yes, so if you have a good internet connection as well as a mobile, definitely all these courses are going to make a very good transformation in your preparation. So what you will get out of these classes, you will get a daily life classes, and then the courses, it will be highly structured. You will get unlimited access to the course. So even if you enroll now, you will get the back access to the January courses, right? And then you will get the access towards the live test as well as the quizzes. Right, everyone? Fine? Alright. So these are the upcoming courses in our platform. And this is the total fee structure. If you like to join for 3 months, definitely you can go with this package. And the code, it is SaranyaLive. Alright. So with this code, definitely you can take it off with this. Right, everyone? Fine. So this is the testimony that is given by my students. So definitely if you think that you will be taking up, definitely you can come up with this. Right. So coming to the next important subtopic. So we are going to see about the conditional specification. So in this conditional specification, so what happens is it is listening to the neighbor. Alright, so this is not having any intrinsic factor, but it trusts the neighbor a lot rather than its own. Got it? Fine. So this neighbor is what it is going to determine and it is going to give the factor. Alright, fine. And so what is going to happen is that, you know, there is no specific cytoplasmic factors within. Okay, so only this neighbor is going to dictate, what the thing is going to take place. So that is why it is called as the conditional specification. Got it? Okay. So the fate, it is not, reported by its own. Rather, the fate is reported by the other one. So that is what is called as your conditional specification. Right. So if you take up the organisms, many organisms are taking up this, and this is also called as the regulation. So what do you mean by this regulative development? Here there is a compensation. Okay. So you remember that, in your autonomous specification, I told you that if at all you remember, remove this I, yes, what will happen to this embryo in your autonomous specification? This embryo, it is going to lack the eye. You remember that? So that is what we have seen in your autonomous specification. But if you take up with this conditional specification, alright, so as of this conditional specification, if you take up this embryo, yes, if you remove the eye, yes, no issues. Why? The neighbor is going to give you the instruction, and then you are going to form an eye. Clear? Yes, everyone? So now you got the difference between what is going to be your autonomous specification and what is going to be the conditional specification. Yes, everyone? So this is clear to you? All right. So that is why the conditional specification is called as regulation. So the most common example you can see is with the sea urchin. Okay. So in the sea urchin, if you take up the four cell stage, if you separate each and every blastomere, this single blastomere, yes, it is going to develop into a normal Plutus larva. Got it? Yes. So how this is happening? This is all because of the regulative development. You call them as the compensatory one, or you call them as the regulatory one. Yes, everybody? So this is all clear to you? Yes, yes. Okay, yeah, everybody, come on. So this is all going to be your compensatory regulation. Oh yes, everybody, come on. So this is what is being called as your regulative development. All right, fine. So let us make a very important theory before we wrap up with our session today. So this is the most important table for the day. Kindly make a note of it. You will definitely get a lot of questions from this topic. Alright, so the first experiment, it was done by Rooks. Right, so what he did, he created a defective experiment. So this defective experiment, what he did, he wanted to prove that it is an autonomous experiment. So what he did, see, he took a hot needle. Okay, yes, so he took a hot needle and he touched one part of this embryo. So what will happen? This one part, it will develop normally, isn't it? Yes. So one half, it is going to develop normally. But this other half, since because it is with the hot needle, there is no development. So it is not being compensated. Whichever is lost forever, isn't it? So that is what was the experiment that was done by the Rooks. So this is called as the defective experiment. Yes, absolutely. So this is what it is called as your mosaic development. And here the most important rule is that your prospective potency, it is equal to the prospective fate. So if it is not there, totally that is getting missed off. Right. So the second one, it is going to be the Dreech experiment. So this Dreech, he did two experiments. Number one, it is going to be this isolation experiment. Yes. Number three, it is going to be the recombination experiment. Right. So let us see about your second experiment of the isolation. So here what he did, he was able to prove this regulative development. If at all he removed a portion from this conditional development CH in embryo, he was able to compensate for it. Why it is compensated? Because this is not giving the signal, the neighbor is only giving the signal. So he was able to compensate it. So that is why this is being called as the regulative development. Here the prospective potency, it is going to be greater than the prospective fate. Got it? Clear? Alright. So the final one, it is called as the recombination experiment. So this was also done by Dreich. So here what he used this pressure plate technique. Mark my words, these already came up in your questions. Yes, this is called as your pressure plate technique. So in the pressure plate technique, what he did, he took an embryo, he pressed hard with this pressure plate. Okay, so what happened, all this blastomere, it get jumbled. Or no, it became recombined. That is why this model is called as the recombination model. Okay, so this is undergoing a regulative development. Here what happens, this potency is going to be greater than the fate. Right? So, but at last he got a very, very normal development. Why? So instead of this one, it is becoming a head. Whatever it was there, let it be two or three, that will become the head. Yes, everybody? So this is a very important hypothesis. So we are going to repeat these three experiments. So that is really very important in your specification. Already questions have come from that. Yes. So number one, it is going to be the Rogue's experiment. So in what he experimented? He experimented with your autonomous specification. Right. So he worked on with your autonomous specification. Alright, fine. So what he did, he took a hot needle and he touched one side of the embryo. So it didn't undergo any development. But this side alone, it formed the complete embryo. So here, the potency is greater than the fate. Got it? Yes. Your potency is equal to the fate. I'm sorry, everyone. So the potency is equal to the fate. Right. So second experiment, it is being done by your Dreich. So he did the isolation experiment. Fine. So whenever he removed one part of this embryo, yes, this missing is being compensated by the neighbors. So this potency is greater than fate. Right. The third experiment is also by Dreich, but that is going to be a recombination experiment. Here he used a pressure plate. So what happened? Instead of this embryo, this is following your 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 pattern. It got jumbled up. Okay, so then 1, next 3, next 6, next 5, 4, 2, like that it got jumbled up. But even then it was jumbled, it was able to form the normal development. How it was forming the normal development? Because the potency is greater than fate. So the neighbor, it is going to give the signal such that it is undergoing a regulative development. These two, they are forming under conditional, it is showing a regulative development. Under the autonomous, it is showing the mosaic development. Oh yes, everyone. So I think all these things are clear to you. So today we learnt about your specification. Yes, we learnt about your induction, right? And then your specification. All right. And then we learnt about the different models of specification, like your autonomous and the conditional. So, and then we saw about your Rogue's experiment, and then we saw about this Dreich experiment. Yes, under Dreich we saw about this isolation and this recombination. Apart from that, in this beginning we had a look at what is going to be this competence factor, and then we had a look at this induction. Yes, everybody. So I hope that this is all clear to you. All right, everyone. So all the very best for your preparation. If at all you have any doubts, just ping me, or else you will end up this class. Yes? Okay, everybody. Thanks a lot. Take care and all the best.